أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اللهم ربنا ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم ارحمنا بالقرآن العظيم. اللهم اجعله لنا إماما ونورا وهدى ورحمة. اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وآناء النهار واجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين. آمين. Dear brothers and sisters and sons and daughters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In the name of Allah and invoking His help, we begin our study of the Quran from the beginning of Surah An-Nisa today. But let me refresh your memory with what I said in the very beginning in the introductory lecture about the grouping of the surahs of the Quran. As you know, Quran consists of 114 surahs. And they are grouped in two ways. One mode of grouping is what we call Ahzab or Manazil. In the Indian subcontinent, we use the word Manzil. In the Arabic world, the term is Hizb. The plural of Hizb is Ahzab. These seven Ahzab, they are nearly equal in volume. And this grouping has been done only with the sole purpose that if a Muslim recites one Hizb every day, he will complete the recitation of the whole of the Quran in a week. So to complete the recitation of the whole of the Quran in 1 week, Quran has been divided into seven Ahzab. But they are not absolutely equal in volume or size. Because if you want to have absolutely equal azab, then you will have to break the surahs. Some surahs are very long. Some are very short. So that is why, you know, these azab are not absolutely equal, they are nearly equal. But there is a very beautiful design in this division. This division was present in the days of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions radiyallahu ta'ala alaihim ajma'in. If you take away Suratul Fatiha, which is the preface to the whole of the Quran, it is called Ummul Kitab, Ummul Quran. Now three surahs comprise first manzil: Suratul Baqarah, Suratul Ali Imran, Suratul Nisa. The next has five surahs. The next has seven surahs. The next has nine surahs. The next 11. The next 13. And the last comprises of 65 surahs. Again, a multiple of 13. 13 into 5 goes to be 65. It's a mathematical system. These are the ahsab. To facilitate a reciter who recites Quran every week. So these 7 portions, he can easily recite 1 portion a day and complete the recitation of the whole of the Quran in 1 week. There's another grouping. And that grouping is based on the subject matter of the surahs. We know, everybody knows, that the Makki and the Madani surahs are interspersed in the whole of the Quran. We find 4 Madani surahs, very long, very lengthy. Suratul Baqarah, Suratul Al Imran, Suratul Nisa, Suratul Maida. Then 2 Makkis, Suratul An'am, which you heard in the Taraweeh today. Then Suratul Araf. Again you have 2 Madanis. Which are they? Suratul Anfal, Suratul Tawbah. Then 14 surahs which are Makkis, and 1 surah which is Madani, that is Suratul Nur. Then several surahs Makki, and again 1 surah Madani, Suratul Ahzab. Then several Makki surahs, and then 3 surahs which are Madani, Suratul Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Suratul Fath, and Suratul Hujarat. Then there are 7 surahs Makki, and then 10 surahs Madani, starting from Suratul Hadid and ending with Suratul Tahreem. Then you know most of the rest of the Quran comprises of the Makki surahs, except for a small number of the surahs in the end of the Quran, which are Madani. So these are 7 groups, Makki Madani, Makki Madani, Makki Madani, 7 times. And each group comprising of 1 or more Makki surahs and 1 or more Madani surahs, it becomes a group. And this each group has a central theme. The Makki surahs of that group and the Madani surahs of that group, they are discussing the 2 aspects of that theme. The same theme. One aspect in the Makki surah and the other aspect in the Madani surah. And so on. So the first group of these comprises of Suratul Fatiha, only 1 surah which is Makki. And what is the central theme of Suratul Fatiha? Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. O Allah, lead us to the right path. Sirat al-lazina anamta alayhim, ghairi al-maghdubi alayhim, wala al-dhalin. Hidayah, guidance, guide us. And not only guide us, lead us to the right path. Now the 4 Madani surahs are giving you that right path. What to do, what not to do. The main theme is Sharia. These things are permissible, they are halal. These things are prohibited, they are haram. You can go this way, not this way. So this is the guidance to the right path. So the main theme of the 4 Madani surahs, Suratul Fatih, Suratul Baqarah, Suratul Al Imran, Suratul Nisa, Suratul Maidah, is the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The right path. As-Siratul Mustaqim. But there is a secondary theme also. And that is the da'wah and then charge sheeting the former Muslim Ummah comprising of the Jews and the Christians. They were the former Muslim Ummah. They were the representatives of Allah on earth for 2,000 years. Moses, alayhi salatu wasalam, was given Torah 1400 years before Christ. And 600 years after Christ is the time of the advent of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So for 2,000 long years, that was the Ummah, Muslim Ummah of that time. But they were deposed. A new ummah was created on the basis of the prophethood of, and messengerhood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We belong to that ummah, thanks to Allah. It's only by the grace of Allah that we belong to that ummah. Because we were born as Muslims. It's only the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But why that former ummah was deposed? So there is a long charge sheet against them. In all these four surahs, so these four surahs now, as I told you, has two themes. Number one, the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and number two, the Dawah and the charge sheet. When they are deposed, are they doomed forever? No. The gate of the mercy of Allah is open for them also. They can also join this ummah. There is no bar. They can believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They can believe in Quran. The moment they do it, they become a part and parcel of this ummah. أَسَارَبُّكُمَ يَرْحَمَكُمْ وَإِنْ عُدْتُمْ عُدْنَا. This is the ayah in Surah Bani Israel, which is the Makki surah. Your Lord is still ready to have mercy upon you. Don't think you are doomed forever. You have been deposed from that position due to your misdeeds. We have created a new ummah. But you can join the ummah. This ummah is not based on any race. So you can join it. You can be a part and part of this ummah. إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ. There is this Quran which is guiding to that path which is the most straight path. So this Dawah, come and join this Ummah. Come and believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Come and believe in this Quran. And the gates of the mercy of Allah are open for you. Allah is ready to embrace you with His mercy. Only if you have faith in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And only if you have faith in Quran. Nothing more is required. The moment you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, you are equal to any Muslim in the world. Not inferior to any Muslim. Now these four surahs, they are divided, or you may say they are divisible, in two pairs of two surahs each. There are certain similarities, you know, between Surah Al-Imran and Surah Al-Baqarah. For example, most apparent, both start with huruf-e-muqatta'at, the alphabets which are pronounced brokenly, separately. Alif, Lam, Mim, Zalik al-Kitab al-Arayb fi. This is the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. Alif, Lam, Mim, Allahu la ilaha illahu. This is the beginning of Surah Al-Imran. The second very apparent, prominent similarity, both the surahs end with very grand prayers. رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَاخِذْنَا إِن نَسِيْنَا وَأَخْطَأْنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا رَبَّنَا وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ وَاعْفُ عَنَّا وَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَارْحَمْنَا أَنْتَ مَوْلَانَا فَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And that is the end of Surah Al-Baqarah. And we find in the last section of Surah Al-Imran, رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا سَمِعْنَا مُنَادِيًا يُنَادِي لِلْإِيمَانِ أَنْ آمِنُوا بِرَبِّكُمْ فَآمَنَّا رَبَّنَا فَاغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَكَفِّرْ عَنَّا سَيِّئَاتِنَا وَتَوَفَّنَا مَعَ الْأَبْرَارِ. رَبَّنَا وَآتِنَا مَا وَعَدتَّنَا عَلَى رُسُلِكَ وَلَا تُخْزِنَا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّكَ لَا تُخْلِفُ الْمِيعَادِ. Very grand prayer. Then we have the similarity. Both the surahs can be divided nearly in two halves. But I can't go into more details. Now we are coming to the second pair, and this consists of Surah Al-Nisa and Surah Al-Ma'idah. And you see, both start abruptly, both end abruptly. No huruf muqatta'at in the beginning of Surah An-Nisa. Ya ayyuha an-nasu ittaqoo rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidatin wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa bassa minhuma rijalan kaseeran wa nisaa'a wattaqullaha alladhi tasaaluna bihi wal arham innallaha kana 'alaykum raqiba. No preface, no preamble, no huruf muqatta'at, no glorification of Allah, no tasbih, no tahmid, nothing of the sort. Direct address starts from the very beginning. In the same way, Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ya ayyuhallazina amanu awfu bil'uqood. Again, no huruf muqatta'at, no tasbih, no tahmid, nothing of the sort. This is the similarity between these two. And we shall be noting the other similar points when we are going through the translation, inshallah. I don't want to spend more of time in this introduction. Now we begin with Surah An-Nisa, with the name of Allah again, and invoking His help again. Ya ayyuhannasu ittaqoo rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidah. Let me tell you a few things about the Surah An-Nisa as a whole also. This consists of 24 sections, 24 rukus, and 176 ayat. And you know, its subject can be divided into two parts. The address to the former ummah, only 37 ayat out of 176 are addressing directly or indirectly the former Muslim ummah with one name, Ya Ahlul Kitab. Either inviting them to embrace Islam or charge sheeting them on their misdeeds. The rest, that is 139 ayat out of 176, they are addressing Muslims as Muslims. But this part also can be divided into two parts. A positive address to the Muslims, real Muslims, true Muslims, showing them the path, showing them the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, showing them how to reform their society, how to uplift the degraded and downtrodden sections of society. This is what I am calling positive side. And there is a negative side also. 55 ayat I am labeling as positive. And 84 as negative. And what do I mean by negative? Here actually, the hypocrites are being discussed and addressed, who were legally Muslims, because they were saying, Ashhadu Allah ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. They were praying behind Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the mosque of the Prophet. But still they were lacking the real faith. They were hypocrites. So exposing them so that the Muslims should know, the fifth columnist among their society, they should beware of their designs and plots. It was necessary to expose them, the hypocrites, and what they were doing, criticizing them, and also exhorting them to mend their ways, have a second look on your attitude. Look what you are doing. You are condemning your own self. You will be doomed. Although you will think that you are Muslims, you will not be accepted and acknowledged as Muslims on the Day of Judgment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we shall find in this surah the strongest condemnation of munafiqeen. إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. These hypocrites will be in the lowest portion, lowest section of Jahannam, of the hell. They are more hated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the kuffar. A kafir is openly kafir. If his enemy is an open enemy, if he attacks you, he's attacking from front. But a munafiq, a hypocrite, he's a hidden enemy. Just like a snake that you are carrying, it can bite you anywhere, at any time. So the major portion of this surah, now note, total number of ayat, 176. Out of these 176, 84 ayat, nearly half of this surah, that consists of dealing the subject of nifaq, criticizing the munafiqeen, exposing them, so that the Muslims should know and recognize the danger that they are facing from the hidden enemy within their ranks, in their society. And also advising them, exhorting them to mend their ways. Still, as I told you, as about the former Muslim Ummah, Allah is ready to embrace you with His mercy. Asa rabbukum an yarhamakum. So, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا آمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَالْكِتَابِ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ وَالْكِتَابِ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ مِنْ قَبْلُ. Oh, you who profess to believe, but don't believe really, have real faith, there's still time to mend. You can save yourself from the eternal punishment of the hereafter, lest this time should finish. So this is the analysis of this surah. Now we are beginning with the first part, but note one point more. These sections, they are interwoven with each other. First, 43 ayat are the positive address to the Muslims. Do this, do this, don't do this, don't do this. You have to respect the women folk. You should look after the orphans. You should divide, you know, whatever somebody, some deceased has left, the property must be divided according to the rules of the Sharia, and so on. The biggest chunk, you know, to the address to the Muslims, it consists of positive ayat, positive commandments, the do's and the don'ts of the Sharia. And then, you know, there is an address to the former Muslim Ummah, Ahl al-Kitab. Then there comes an address to the Munafiqeen, but note one thing. Nowhere in the Quran, the munafiqeen, the hypocrites are addressed as Ya ayyuhal ladheena nafaqu, Ya ayyuhal munafiqoon. Nowhere. Because they were also Muslims, legal Muslims. So they are also addressed Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu. Oh, you who profess to believe, but lack the real belief. But these things are in bracket, not in express words. Only you have to ponder over the subject of the ayat to decide whether the addressee of this ayat is the Muslim Ummah, the real mu'min, or the addressee of these ayat are the munafiqun. So that you have to know for yourself. Now starting from the first section. Ya ayyuhan nasu ittaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum. O mankind, have taqwa of your Lord, your Master, your Rabb. Now to translate this word taqwa is very difficult, rather impossible. Most of the translators, they use the word fear Allah, fear God, fear your Rabb, fear your Lord. To say the least, it is not appropriate. For fear, the word in Quran is khawf. Everybody knows. What is taqwa? Waqayaqi means to save someone from some harm. And ittaqa means to save yourself. To save yourself from what? You save yourself from moral decay. And save yourself from the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is the meaning of taqwa. Therefore, I'm glad that some of the modern translators, they are translating it in a different way. For example, have regard for Allah. Ya ayyuhan nas ittaqu rabbakum. O mankind, have regard for your Lord. This is a better translation. O you who believe, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. Remain mindful of your Lord. This is a better translation. Remain dutiful towards your Lord. Keep your moral sense alive. So at different places, I'll be using different words, but not fear. You know, we have given the opportunity to the Christians. They blame Quran. That Quran invokes fear. Fear is not a positive sentiment. It's negative. They say, Bible invokes love of Allah, love of God. And Quran invokes fear of Allah. And this is because we have translated so many words with one word, and that is fear. Taqwa, fear. Khawf, fear. Khashiyya, fear. Inzar, to make somebody fear. Fear and fear and fear and fear, so they had the chance due to this wrong translations. So we should use better words now. O mankind, have regard for your Lord, الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ, who created you out of one living being. Please note here, the word is not from Adam, not from Bashar, not from Rajul. Not that he created you out of one man or one human being, no. Nafs, what is nafs? Life. When you know the angel of Allah will come, putting us to death, what will they say? Akhriju anfusakum. Let me take out your life. Malakul maut will come and say, Akhriju anfusakum. So nafs means a living organism. So Allah has created you all from one living organism, one living being. وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا, and He created out of that living being its mate. Now this translation comes very near the modern biological and zoological ideas. You know, in the beginning, when life started on this planet Earth, the primitive forms of life, unicellular organism, it had no sex. The procreation was by the division. One cell dividing into two. Two into four. Four into eight. Going on. That was the procreation. Later on, there appeared sex. And we find in the beginning, both sexes in one organism. Then at a later stage of evolution, the sexes separated. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. Now when the sexes were separated, now there was Adam and Eve. And you know, the second ayah which discusses the same theme in the Quran is ayah number 13 of Surah Al-Hujurat. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْسَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ مِنْ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. Here, ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْسَى, one male, one female, one man, one woman, Adam and Eve. But here it is, خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. And from these two, from this pair, He spread so many men and women in this earth. 5 billions or 6 billions of them are today the progeny of Adam and Eve. Wattaqullah. Just note how important this taqwa is. In one ayah it is being emphasized again. Same ayah, the first ayah. Wattaqullah. Have regard for Allah. Remain mindful of your duties towards Allah. Keep Allah in your mind always. Never to forget. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَعَلُونَ بِهِ, in whose name you ask each other. if some beggar is asking you for some alms, what does he say? Allah ke naam pe. In the name of Allah, please give me. In the name of Allah, please forgive me also, if you want to have forgiveness from somebody. I'm sorry, please forgive me. In the name of Allah, I appeal to you. So if you have to appeal to each other, and you ask each other any favors, with the name of Allah, so you must keep Allah. Be yourself dutiful to Him. Be yourself obedient to Him. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. And you must respect the relationship related to the wombs, the womb of the mother. Sons and daughters are coming from the same place. They have a relationship due to the womb of the mother, brothers and sisters. Now you rise up, the womb of the grandmother. Here the cousins, they join together. Both ascending. And you will reach the womb of Eve, alayhi salatu wasalam. And the whole of mankind comes within the folds of a universal brotherhood. This is the relationship of the womb. Because I told you, the reformation of the society, that is the main subject of these first 43 ayahs of this surah. And what's the basis of society? The basis of society, the unit of society is a family. I read, you know, today there was a very big ad, full page ad, you know, in New York Times, perhaps yesterday or day before, from the American Family Association, perhaps. Now they are very much fearful. This institution is breaking. It has decayed. Even the president of the United States of America said that very soon the majority of the American nation will consist of bastards born out of any legal wedlock. One parent family. The family has gone to ruins. To reform this family, to make it a very strong institution. Because, you know, the wall is made of blocks or bricks. If each brick is strong, then the wall will be strong. So this society is composed of families. If each family is strong, disciplined, organized, then the whole society will be organized and disciplined. And this family, what joins them is the womb, wombs of the mothers. Wal arham, just note how much importance Quran is stressing on this kingship, this relationship due to wombs. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَالُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. Here you have to use the word ittaqu again. وَاتَّقُوا الْأَرْحَامِ وَالْأَرْحَامَ. It is maful. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ. Have regard for Allah. وَاتَّقُوا الْأَرْحَامَ. And have regard for this relationship based on the wombs of your mothers. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watchful over you. He's seeing you, watching you, what you are doing. وَآتُ الْيَتَامَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ. The second downtrodden section of the society, orphans. Women and then orphans. The women have been exalted. The womb of the mother brought closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاتَّقُوا الْأَرْحَامِ. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَالُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. You know the position of the mother, the respect that you must show to her. Al-jannatu tahta aqdamil ummahat, the Prophet said, paradise is under the feet of the mothers. Now the second section, downtrodden, oppressed. Atul yatama amwalahum. Hand over to the orphans their properties and belongings. If somebody has died, she has left orphans. They are still minor. They can't look after their affairs. The whole thing goes in the hands of the uncles. And now those uncles are not paying and giving away, giving over the property of the orphans to them. They are eating it up. So these are now deprived. You must hand over the property of the orphans to them. وَلَا تَتَبَدَّلُوا الْخَبِيثَ بِالطَّيِّبِ. Don't change anything which is bad of your possessions with something which is good in their possession. I will give these things to him. Well, the bad things I can change, you know. I can place here. I will complete the number of this orphan. Your father had left 10 camels. Well, I have given you 10 camels. But not the good camels that the father had left, but the weak ones, the diseased ones. وَلَا تَتَبَدَّلُوا الْخَبِيثَ بِالطَّيِّبِ وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَهُمْ أَمْوَالَهُمْ إِلَىٰ أَمْوَالِكُمْ. Don't try to eat up their property by mixing it with your own property. When you intermix the two, then it's very easy to be dishonest. You must keep the property of the orphan, which is under your guardianship, separate, discreet. Don't mix it with your, so that you can, knowingly or unknowingly, you misuse your authority and you eat up their property. إِنَّهُ كَانَ حُوبًا كَبِيرًا. Verily, it's a very big crime in the eyes of Allah. وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تُخْسِطُوا فِي الْيَتَامَى. And if you fear, you are afraid that you will not be able to do justice to the orphan girls. This ayah is very important because some of the people who don't believe in hadith or sunnah of the Prophet, the munkarin of sunnah, they have misinterpreted this ayah. The real interpretation comes from a hadith, from Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And we shall see that very explanation is given by Quran itself in ayah number 127 of this very surah. We shall read it, inshallah. What is the background of this ayah? Because, you know, if somebody had minor orphan girls under his guardianship, and that minor girl had some property also which was left over by her parents. Now a person who is the guardian marries her. There's no need of giving any dowry. She's under your control. She's already under your thumb. And there's nobody to ask for her rights. You can treat her as you like. Because she was an orphan. She didn't have anybody, any father, any brothers to look after her rights. So they used to do it. Well, this is the orphan. I marry her. Now all the property comes to me and nobody is there to ask for the rights of this orphan girl. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تُخْسِتُوا فِي الْيَتَامَى. If you are afraid that you won't be able to do justice in case of the orphan girls. Here yatama means the orphan girls. فَانْكِحُوا. Don't marry them. But marry مَا تَابَ لَكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَىٰ. You can marry other women who please you, whom you like. مَسْنَا وَسُلَاسَ وَرُبَاعَ. The Sharia of Allah is allowing you to have two wives at a time, three at a time, even four at a time, not more. That is the last. مَسْنَا وَسُلَاسَ وَرُبَاعَ. There are so many women. If you have to marry, you can marry other women. Don't marry this orphan girl which is under your guardianship because you won't be able to do justice to her. And she will not be backed by any support from her own family. So you are very much liable to do injustice. وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تُخْسِطُوا فِي الْيَتَامَى فَانْكِحُوا مَا تَابَ لَكُمْ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ مَثْنَى وَثُلَاثَ وَرُبَاعَ. You are allowed to marry two or three or four at a time. وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا. But this permission of marrying more than one woman is conditional. إِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا. If you are afraid you won't be able to do justice between these wives, فَوَاحِدَةٌ. Then you should have only one wife because you have to do justice. Justice in all the measurable things. all the measurable things. The time that you spend with this wife must be equal to the time you are spending with the other wife. The money that you are giving monthly for household management to this wife, the same money should be given to the other wife. Anything which can be counted, which can be measured, must be absolutely equal. That is the condition. وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا. Permission is there. You can have two wives, three wives, four wives at a time. But this is the condition. You have to fulfill this justice. Only there is one exception. There may be, you know, your heart is more inclined to one and not that much inclined to the other. But this is beyond your control. And this will be made clear in this very surah. We shall find in the next passages that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted that this is the weakness of man. So this is pardonable. But whatever can be measured or counted, in that absolute equality has to be maintained. Time, money, dresses, etc., etc., dwelling, they must be absolutely equal at par with each other. وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدَلُوا فَوَاحِدَةٌ وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. And in addition to the wives, you can have those slave girls whom your right hands possess. They are besides. They are not counted in wives. Wives are separate. ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَلَّا تَعُولُوا. This is more likelier that you won't go astray and you won't be deviate. You won't deviate from the right path. So if you keep only one wife, you are saved from doing any injustice. You will not be responsible on the day of judgment for any injustice to any of one of them. So it's better to have one. This is persuasion. It's safer to have one. But you are allowed. There can be circumstances that a person needs more than one wife. You can, but you have to do justice. Full justice to all your wives. And not beyond four. وَآتُ النِّسَاءَ صَدُقَاتِهِنَّ نِحْلَةً. Again. And give over to the women their dowry, their bridal money, mahar, which we call. Sadoqat, this is sadoqat. Singular is sadaq. Sadaq means the bridal money which a husband pays to the bride, which we call mahar. So you must pay the mahar, or the bridal money, or the door, or the dowry, with pleasure, nihla. Don't think it's some fine that you have to pay. It's not a fine, it's a present to your would-be wife. And you know, sadaqah means alms or charity. And the plural is sadaqat. So please differentiate sadaqat and sadaqat. Sadaqat is from sadaqah. And sadaqat is from sidaq. And sidaq is the bridal money which is paid by the husband to the bride, to the wife, at the time of marriage. وَآتُ النِّسَاءَ صَدُقَاتِهِنَّ نِحْلَةً فَإِنْ تِبْنَ لَكُمْ عَنْ شَيْءٍ. If they on their own concede some part of their dowry to you, well, you had promised me $10,000, well, I give you 1,000 out of it. I am ready to accept 9,000. Okay. It's her authority. She can do it. فَقُلُوهُ هَنِيًّا مَرِيًّا. You can eat it, you can use it, consume it. And you can consume it with pleasure and doing no good to you, no bad to you. وَلَا تُوتُ السُّفَهَا أَمْوَالَكُمْ أَلَّتِي جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ قِيَامًا. And don't hand over your properties to the feeble-minded. Sufaha, foolish, feeble-minded, retarded mentally. There are people. Perhaps an orphan is retarded in mind, mentally retarded. His father had left much property for him. Now if you hand over that property to this person, he will spoil it because he doesn't have the intelligence and the understanding and the wisdom and the maturity of thinking. Don't hand over the property to such people. You know, it is in these type of cases that during the British Raj in India, there was court of war. If there was such minor people who inherited big properties, that those properties were not left at their own like or dislike, at their own disposal. But the government managed it for them, and they were allowed only annual expenditure out of the income of that property. That was called court of war. And this is something which is necessary in a society. Because there can be people who don't know what is good for them, what is bad for them. وَلَا تُوتُوا السُّفَهَا أَمْوَالَكُمُ الَّتِي جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ قِيَامًا. These properties, these belongings, these things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a support for you in this world. So if you give them over to these people who are not mentally fit, who are not mentally up to mark, then you are spoiling it. And this is going to be a loss to the community, not to the individual alone. وَرْزُقُوهُمْ فِيهَا. But you feed them from that. وَقْسُوهُمْ. And clothe them. Give the proper clothing, give the proper food out of the income of that property. وَقُولُوا لَهُمْ قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا. And say to them kind words. Don't be harsh to them, although they are mentally retarded. But you know, don't be harsh to them. You have to be, to treat them gently. وَقْتُلُوا الْيَتَامَى حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغُوا النِّكَاحِ. And keep on testing the orphans till such time that they come of age, they reach the age of marriage, they reach the age of puberty. Now they are not minors, they are adults. فَإِنْ آنَسْتُمْ مِنْهُمْ رُشْدًا. If you see that they are intelligent, they can very well understand what is good for them, what is bad for them. فَدْفَعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ أَمْوَالَهُمْ. Now hand over to them their property, which was under in your custody. It was the property of the orphan. His father had left that property for him, but because he was a minor, you were the guardian, you were the custodian. But now when he has come of age, and now when he has reached the age of puberty, hand over their property to them. وَلَا تَأْكُلُوهَا إِسْرَافًا. Don't eat it up. إِسْرَافًا, extravagantly. وَبِدَارًا أَنْ يَكْبَرُوا. And hastily, fearing that they may become majors, they become adults. وَمَنْ كَانَ. So that you are finishing it up before they become adults. Don't do it. These were the things that were being done over there. These were the social evils in that society. And now when, you know, Muslims had a society of their own, a system of their own, a state of their own, so to say, now it had, the society had to be reformed from all respects. You see how much detailed the Quran is giving these instructions. Don't do any injustice to any section of the society, especially the weaker section. Women are weak, so are the orphans. وَابْتَلُوا الْيَتَامَى حَتَّى إِذَا بَلَغُوا النِّكَاحَ فَإِنْ آنَسْتُم مِّنْهُمْ رُشْدًا فَادْفَعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ أَمْوَالَهُمْ وَلَا تَأْكُلُوهَا إِسْرَافًا وَبِدَارًا أَن يَكْبَرُوا وَمَنْ كَانَ غَنِيًّا فَلْيَسْتَعْفِفْ. If a guardian of an orphan is himself rich and self-sufficient, he should abstain and he should not take anything out of the property of the orphan whose he is looking after. But وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا. If some guardian is poor and he is devoting his time, he is looking after the property of the orphan, so he can take something on that account from the property of the orphan. وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا فَلْيَاكُلْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. But then they should do it in a good way. Not that they are drawing heavy sums and heavy salaries out of the property. But you know the thing which is correct, just and fair. فَإِذَا دَفَعْتُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ أَمْوَالَهُمْ. And when you have handed over to them their properties, فَأَشْهِدُوا عَلَيْهِمْ. Take witnesses. Lest the orphan says, no, he didn't give it to me. The detailed instructions, these are real matters, real problems. How many disputes can arise? So have witnesses that this was the property left by his father. Today, I am handing it over. You be witnesses to it. Ashhadu alayhim. Wa kafa billahi hasiba. And Allah is sufficient to reckon. He will take the account himself also. Don't think that if you have kept an account of the property of the orphan and you have the witnesses also, and now there is no other place where you are answerable and responsible, on the day of judgment Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also take the account. Had you taken it justly or not? لِلْرِجَالِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ. For men is also a portion from what was left by their parents or near relatives. Now this is the law of inheritance which will be decided, which will be discussed in detail in the second section. This is just a preamble for that. لِلْرِجَالِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ. Both the parents, father and mother, whatever they have left. Now men also have a share from that inheritance. وَلِلنِّسَاءِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ. And in the same way, women have also a share. Now this is a very big reform which was being done by Islam. Because before Islam, there was no share of inheritance for women. There is still no share in inheritance in Hindus till this time. No share. The inheritor is only the male, and in most of the cases, only the eldest son. Even the smaller sons and younger sons and daughters, they are just deprived of everything, so that the holding remains big. It is not divided and distributed. That is the custom in many societies. But Quran says no. لِلْرِجَالِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ وَلِلنِّسَاءِ نَصِيبٌ مِمَّا تَرَكَ الْوَالِدَانِ وَالْأَقْرَبُونَ مِمَّا قَلَّ مِنْهُ أَوْ كَثُرَ. Whether that property or whatever has been left by the parents or the relatives is small or great, it doesn't matter. Howsoever small it is, you have to divide it according to the divine law. If it is great, it has to be divided. If it is small, مِمَّا قَلَّ مِنْهُ أَوْ كَثُرَ. Don't think, oh, it's a very small thing, why to divide it? No. This is the commandment of Allah. نَصِيبًا مَفْرُوضًا. These portions, you know, they have been ordained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not a human law that can be amended and changed. It has been decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذَا حَضَرَ الْقِسْمَةَ أُولُو الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. And when at the time of division of the inheritance, some relatives also come and they are present, and there are some orphans also. They are not the inheritors, not the son, not the daughter of the deceased, but they are of orphans of the family. They may be related, but you know, a distant relations. وَالْمَسَاكِينَ, or the poor. If they also, they are present, destitutes are also present, give them also, فَاتُوهُمْ مِنْهُ وَقُولُوا فَرْزُقُوهُمْ مِنْهُ وَقُولُوا لَهُمْ قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا. Give something out of that inheritance to them also, and talk to them in a very gentle way. Kind words. وَلْيَخْشَ الَّذِينَ لَوْ تَرَكُوا مِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّةً ضِعَافًا. And those who are dividing that property now, they should fear. Now this is khashiyah. Khashiyah means fear. Khauf means fear. If they should think about it, that had they been in the place of this person deceased, and had they been leaving behind them minor sons or daughters, how much they would be fearing about their future. Khafu alayhim. A man is dying and he is leaving minor sons, minor daughters. How much he will be mindful about the future of these kids, who will look after them? They need protection, they need support. I'm dying, who will look after them? So you should keep it in mind. So now if the other orphans are coming, they were also the sons of some deceased person. Be kind to them, so that if that time comes, God forbid, but if that time comes for your kids and sons and daughters, people will be kind to them also, if you are kind to the orphans today. وَلْيَخْشَ الَّذِينَ لَوْ تَرَكُوا مِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّةً ضِعَافًا خَافُوا عَلَيْهِمْ فَلْيَتَّقُوا اللَّهِ. So they should have regard of Allah. وَلْيَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. And they must say the correct words, the straight words. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَى ظُلْمًا. Verily those who are eating up the property of the orphans In zulman innama yaakuluna fi butunihim nara. They are filling their bellies with fire. Basa yaslawna sa'ira, and they shall enter a blazing fire. Don't think that if you have consumed the property of the orphan, well, you have consumed it. No. This is not the property of the orphan that you have consumed and put in your bellies. It's the fire of hell. It will appear on the day of judgment. That was actually, they were the living cinders of fire. Yusikumullahu fi awladikum. I think we should take 1.5 hours in this session. Or maybe 2 hours, because we can't say 4 taraweeh with only 10 ayat. So we have to say at least 4 taraweeh. For that we must have some ayat, you know. So let it be 2 hours. Yusikumullahu fi awladikum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoins upon you regarding your children. لِلزَّكَرِ مِسْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. This is a very profound place of the Quran. This section consists of only 4 ayat. And in 2 ayat, the whole law of inheritance has been stated here. And people, you know, who are experts on this law of inheritance, they have written full volumes, full books based on these 2 ayat. They are so profound. It's a miracle of Quran. يُوسِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ. Now this is the beginning of the law of inheritance in Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoins upon you about your sons and daughters, your children. Number one thing, لِلزَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. For the male there is a portion equal to the portion of 2 females. This is one principle, basic principles. For the son, twice the share of the daughter. For the mother, for the father, twice the share of the mother. That is the general principle. For the males, that is why the word is لِلزَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. For the males, and here it is sons, because awlad. يُوسِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ لِلزَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. The son will get the share equal to the share of 2 daughters. فَإِنْ كُنَّ نِسَانْ فَوْقَسْنَتَيْنِ. But if there are only daughters, more than 2, or even 2 also. فَلَهُنَّ ثُلُثَا مَا تَرَكْ. They will have only 2/3 of the property of the deceased, not all of it. The 1/3 will go to some other people, you know. That is not discussed here, that is given by the hadith. فَإِنْ كَانَتْ وَاحِدَةً. And if it is only 1 daughter, the only daughter, no son, no other daughter, she will inherit falahannis, half of the property, not the whole of the property. The half, the rest half will go to some other people, to the brothers of the deceased, etc., etc. But if one daughter is the inheritor only, she will have only half. What does it mean? If there is only 1 son, then the whole property will be inherited by him. The son will, because لِلزَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. Because for the male, the share is equal to the share of the 2 daughters, two females. So if there is only 1 son, he will inherit the whole property. If it is only 1 daughter, she will have only half. وَلِأَبْوَيْهِ لِكُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَ السُّدُسُ مِمَّا تَرَكَ إِنْ كَانَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ. Now you come to the, you know, parents. If the deceased person has progeny, has sons and daughters, then to the parents, to the father and mother both, 1/6 will go. That is 1/3 in total. لِكُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا السُّدُسُ. 1/6. From what the deceased has left, if he had some sons or daughters. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ وَلَدٌ وَوَرِثَهُ أَبَوَاهُ. And if he had, the deceased had no sons or daughters, no offspring, now the only inheritors, the sole inheritors are the parents, father and the mother. فَلِأُمِّهِ الثُّلُثُ. Then for the mother will be the 1/3 of the whole of property. Now if the 1/3 goes to mother, what goes to the father? 2/3. Again it is complete. فَإِنْ كَانَ لَهُ إِخْوَةٌ فَلِأُمِّهِ الثُّلُثُ. But if there are, you know, brothers and sisters of the deceased, then for the mother will be 1/3, 1/6. مِن بَعْدِ وَسِيَّةٍ يُوصِي بِهَا أَوْ دَيْنٍ. And this distribution will be made after, if any bequest had been bequeathed, that will be fulfilled. And after, if there was any loan on the deceased, that loan will be paid. This division and distribution will be after two things. مِن بَعْدِ وَسِيَّةٍ يُوصِي بِهَا أَوْ دَيْنٍ. If there is some bequest, that has to be fulfilled. And number two, if there is some loan, that has to be paid first, and then the rest of the property will be distributed according to this law of inheritance. آباؤكم وابناؤكم, your sons or your fathers, لا تدرون أيهم أقرب لكم نفعا, you don't know who is nearer to you in benefit, because this is Allah who knows what should go to the parents, what should go to the offsprings. This is Allah, He decides. فَرِيضَةً مِّنَ اللَّهِ. This is an injunction, this is an ordinance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا. And verily Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. His wisdom is complete, His knowledge is complete. And He is giving you these instructions out of His total wisdom, out of His total knowledge. وَلَكُمْ نِصْفُ مَا تَرَكَ أَزْوَاجُكُمْ إِن لَّمْ يَكُن لَّهُنَّ وَلَدٌ. And you will have half of the property of your wives if they have no offspring. A woman dies without any offspring, no son, no daughter. Now the inheritor is this husband, but he will get half of the property. The rest of half will go to the brothers and sisters of that woman, that deceased woman. لَكُمْ نِصْفُ مَا تَرَكَ أَزْوَاجُكُمْ إِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُنَّ وَلَدٌ. If the woman didn't have any offspring or children, فَإِنْ كَانَ لَهُنَّ وَلَدٌ, but if she had some offsprings, daughters or sons, فَلَكُمُ الرُّبُعُ مِمَّا تَرَكْنَا, then you will inherit only one-fourth of what they have left. مِنْ بَعْدِ وَصِيَّةٍ يُوصِينَ بِهَا أَوْ دَيْنٍ. And again the same two conditions, after the bequest that she had bequeathed, and after the payment of the loan. وَلَهُنَّ الرُّبُعُ, now the opposite. وَلَهُنَّ الرُّبُعُ, and she will, and they will, and the women, the wives, they will inherit one-fourth مِمَّا تَرَكْتُمْ, of what you have left. إِن لَمْ يَكُنْ لَكُمْ وَلَدْ, if you don't have any sons or daughters, then the wife will have one-fourth. فَإِنْ كَانَ لَكُمْ وَلَدٌ, but if you have a daughter or a son, an offspring, فَلَهُنَّ أَثْثُمُنُ مِمَّا تَرَكْتُمْ, then they will inherit from your property inheritance only one-eighth. Again the same principle, male and female, rub and sumun, one-fourth, one-eighth. مِمَّا تَرَكْتُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ وَصِيَّةٍ تُوصُونَ بِهَا أَوْ دَيْنٍ, the same two conditions, after the bequest had been bequeathed and after the loan had been paid. وَإِنْ كَانَ رَجُلٌ يُورَثُ كَلَالَةً. Now there is another condition. A person who has left property and he has died, and he is kalala. What is kalala? He has no inheritor, not even in the sons and daughters, nor in the parents. We call it usul and furoo. Asl is the root. The root of the person are the parents, from where he has come. This is asl, usul. Furoo, branches. Branches are the sons and the daughters. So primary inheritors are the usul, that is the parents, and the furoo, and that is the offspring, sons and daughters. This is the primary inheritance. Then secondarily, wife and husband, husband and wife. So they are the first circle of inheritance. Now if a person, whether he is a woman or a man, he or she has died, she had no, or he had no sons or daughters, nor the parents were alive. Now such a woman or a man is called kalala. وَإِنْ كَانَ رَجُلٌ يُورَثُ كَلَالَةً أَوْ إِمْرَأَةٌ. In this both the cases, whether he is a male or a female, she is a female. If they don't have any sons or daughters or parents alive, وَلَهُ أَخٌ وَأُخْتٌ, but they have that kalala, that man or woman, they have either one brother or one sister. فَلِكُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَ الثُّلُثُ. And now this will be very clear in the last ayah of this surah, ayah number 176, that here the sisters and brothers are those from mother's side only. We say that he is my real brother. What do you mean? That Father is the same, mother is the same. But if father or mother is different, only you, the common is one, either the father is common or the mother is common, we call them step-brothers. Sotele bhai behen. In Arabic, according to Islamic law, there are three types. Aini, allati, akhlafi. Any brothers and sisters are those who have common brother, common father, common mother. Number two, father is common, but the mothers are different. They are called allati. Mother is the same, fathers are different. Then they are called akhlafi. So this is the case of the akhlafi. According to the Sharia, if the father is common, it is irrelevant whether the mother is common or not. They are real brothers, real sisters. Mothers may be different because it is the male, the father, who is the decisive factor. So they are called reals. Akhyafi for the akhyafi, where only the mother is common, fathers are different. This is the case of the akhyafi. If a woman or man dies without having any parents alive or any sons or daughters, and they have only akhyafi, only those type of step brothers or sisters who are only from the mother's side, then for each one of them is only 1/6 of the inheritance. فَإِنْ كَانُوا أَكْسَرَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ فَهُمْ فِي شُرَكَى فَهُمْ شُرَكَى. If there are so many brothers and sisters, then the property will be divided among them. This 1/6 will be divided in فِسْسُنُسْ. 1/3 will be divided between them equally. مِنْ بَعْدِ وَسِيَّةٍ يُوسَى بِهَا أَوْدَيْنَ. And this will also happen after that wasiyah, that bequest has been completed, fulfilled, or the loan has been given. غَيْرَ مُضَارْ. Without harming anyone. What can be the conditions of harming? For example, somebody has made a bequest for his own son. He had crossed the limits of the Sharia. For those whose share in inheritance is fixed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can't give any wasiyah for them. La wasiyata li warisin. So if somebody has done something wrong, well, that must be rectified. The divine law will be supreme. The portions of the inheritors have been fixed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The son will get his own share according to the Sharia. The daughter will get her own share according to the Sharia. You can't make any wasiyah, any bequest in favor of the son or the daughter, or the father or the mother. This bequest can be for others, for some charity works, for some other distant relations, for some orphans and so on. But if the wasiyah is for the waris, then it is not, you know, obligatory, but rather it is false. غَيْرَ مُضَارْ وَسِيَّةً مِّنَ اللَّهِ. And this is injunction from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many times you see this is being repeated? So that you must be mindful that you can't make any changes, any amendments. This is the ordinance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. And Allah is Alim, all-knowing, Hakim, all-wise. Tilka hududullah. And these are the limits placed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alimul Halim, I'm sorry. He is the knower and forbearing. He is forbearing. He doesn't punish you immediately. He gives you time to amend your ways. He is Halim. So this is his Hilm. Wallahu alimul Halim. Tilka hududullah. These are the limits placed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again the emphasis. And how lightly we take this matter. What percentage of Muslims are serious about these matters? There were Muslims in India, and there must be today even in Bharat and Pakistan both and Bangladesh. They used to stand up in the British courts and say, we don't accept the law of inheritance of Islam. We want the law of the inheritance of our rivaj. What is there, you know, in our society? We want a decision according to rivaj. Or we want a decision according to the British law. We are not ready to accept Islamic law. And they were Muslims. They declared it. And you know the emphasis here. Tilka hududullah. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ يُدْخِلْهُ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ. These are the limitations. which have been prescribed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, He will make him enter those gardens, tajri min tahti al-anhar, underneath which rivers will be flowing, khalidina fiha, and they will abide therein forever. Bazalik al-fawdul azim, and that is a very great achievement indeed. Whosoever is made to enter paradise, what greater achievement and success can be there? وَمَنْ يَعْسِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ And whosoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger, وَيَتَعَدَّ حُدُودَهُ And he tramples the limits placed by, transgresses the limits placed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يُدْخِلْهُ النَّارَ He will make him to enter the fire, خَالِدًا فِيهَا To abide there forever. وَلَهُ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ And there he will have a humiliating chastisement, punishment. I think we should stop here and we should pray 4 rakat of Taraweeh.
Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Azim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati mazdik al-Hakim.
Allahu Akbar,
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having 4 levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us. or call our toll-free number, 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together, we can make a difference.